raised the criticism that this approach, while very successful in many respects, is not appropriate for others, which do not have a field of their own. In his own talk, he proposed an alternative in which the asymptotic condition in terms of fields was replaced by one in terms of localized states created from the vacuum by what we now call a local algebra. And this was the birth of Hart-Riel scattering theory and, in fact, of algebraic quantum field theory. Besides scattering theory, the main issues of AQFT during the first decades were charges and symmetries. The celebrated duality theory for superselection sectors was one of its major achievements. Yet, the subtleties of the electric charge, as well as the algebraic signature of gauge symmetries, still remains a challenge today. Mm-hmm. A most seminal new concept came from the application of the methods of AQFT, C-star algebras, to quantum statistical mechanics, namely modular theory. It took several decades until this theory revealed its full power for quantum field theory. Eventually, its intimate relationship to CPT was discovered. The relation to the scattering matrix, to the size of phase space, the relation to Lorentz invariance and the positivity of energy, and to locality itself. The second seminal development in AQFT is its opening towards general covariance. We have learned to talk of energy when there is no Fourier transform, to talk of spin when there are no rotations, and of ground states when there is no vacuum. Someday we shall also understand how locality works when there is no space-time. All in all, AQFT is an approach to quantum field theory where the Q stands in the front. It focuses on its intrinsic features, which are genuine quantum, and not deformations of classical pictures. Or, as the song goes, do you remember the song? Der Lagrangian ist irgendwo tief versteckt im A von O. We are happy that so many young researchers have registered for our conference. Even more, we are happy that the pioneers of this approach can be here today. Rudolf Haag, Hans-Jürgen Borchers is not here, I think. Hunsihiro Araki, John Roberts, Sergio Doblicher, to name only a few, all of them kept mentally fresh under the spell of AQFT. We wish them and all of you an inspiring conference. Sorry, one more point. This is the occasion to thank our sponsors. The Courant Center Higher Order Structures in Mathematics, the Institutes for Theoretical Physics, and the International Association of Mathematical Physics, all of them for financial support, and the first two also for the invaluable help in the persons of Mrs. Gabler and Mrs. Dingenotto, which you have met outside, taking care of most administrative matters, and Mrs. Lütke Hampe for her help in various other organizations. Now I give the word to the chairman, and
we'll open
the
second part. Well, it is a pleasure and a privilege to chair a session in which the protagonist of algebraic quantum field theory is the speaker. The relevance and range of 50 years development of the theory, I think, will become evident in many talks, so I don't have to comment on this. So I directly pass the word to Mark to give a talk on the early years of quantum field theory.
Thank you. So, good morning. Can you hear me? Okay. Well, I think I could save my talk because Henning Rehren already essentially told you everything. But since I'm here, I also have to talk. Yeah? Now, when Detlef Buchholz first told me about his plan to organize this conference, I was between mixed feelings, because of course on the one hand I was naturally very pleased and flattered that he had dug out my old contribution to the Lille conference and recognized its seminal value. On the other hand, I found it somewhat exaggerated to celebrate 50 years anniversary of that thing. It reminded me a little bit of a road sign which I often passed in the Midwest when I drove from Urbana to Argonne National Laboratory through the fertile country there. And there was a tiny settlement in which there was a road sign, "Great was the past, greater will be the future." Now, for those of you who are below 35 years of age, maybe you could adopt this slogan and have it as a challenge for further work. Now, the looking at the audience, at the list of participants also, I was really surprised how many people from very far away did come to this conference and follow the call of Detlef Buchholz. So I think it is a good sign that the area is still reasonably alive. But we should not forget that there is another reason for this gathering, namely that it is the last term of Detlef Buchholz as a professor of theoretical physics at the University of Göttingen. He will retire next fall, at this fall. Now, this retirement may always be a mixed affair. On the one hand, one loses something, on the other hand, one gains something. So I hope that the gain in freedom, not having to do administrative duties and not having to give lectures, will be more important than the loss, and that Detlef will have time to think and enjoy life as a free man. So okay, so much to this. Now, let me look back at the years 52 to 54, because these were the years in which I first met, so to say, the international scene. In 52, there was a conference in Copenhagen, the parallel conference to the foundation of CERN, at which I could attend. And in 53, 54, I could spend the whole year in Copenhagen as a member of the CERN Theoretical Study Group. And these were, of course, very essential years for me. Now, the situation at that time, in particular the 52 conference, in experimental high energy physics, there was enormous motion, enormous expansion, and it marked the transition from cosmic ray physics, which was up to then the essential source of information about elementary high energy particles, and accelerator physics with the planning of the huge machines in CERN and in Brookhaven, 25 GeV machines. So that was a transition period. On the side of the theory, there was the spectacular success of quantum electrodynamics, which had restored faith in quantum field theory, though there were many dark spots left over, and the whole scheme looked more like a bag of tricks than a coherent theory. Dirac rejected it as ugly, and Heisenberg thought that it might be a tactical advance, but it would be a disaster, in a strategic disaster, he called it, because he felt that it drew the energy away from the really important problems to some sideline. But anyhow, the success of electrodynamics with the wonderful numbers they presented and the elimination of infinities was of course something which had to be taken serious. There was obviously some physics in quantum field theory. Now, well, by contrast, the theory of strong interactions was in very poor shape, and it had just become clear that the perturbation methods in the Yukawa field theory led to no good results at all, and there were no other approximation methods of any reliability in sight. So in 1953, in this CERN theoretical study group, we were, so to say, asked to think about approximation methods which would be applicable for strong interactions. But this group, there was no concerted effort possible because the composition of this group was with one representative from each country, which was a member of CERN, and they were of very unequal background, very unequal training, and so Christian Möller, who was in charge of this group, he left everybody do whatever he liked. It was a very friendly atmosphere and very nice. And by the, yes, for me, I could not resist the temptation to pursue my pet project, which was to develop some frame for relativistic quantum theory, starting from Wigner's work on the representations of the Poincaré group and on symmetries in general. And by the extreme benevolence of Christian Möller, I could present my ideas in a long series of seminars all through the year 1953. And the lecture notes came out in end of 1953 with the title, let's see, what was it? What was it now? The quantum theory of interacting particles or something of that sort. It was widely distributed, and it was in fact my entrance ticket to the great world in the United States a few years later. Now, what concerns us here is only one aspect of these lecture notes, namely the attitude towards the basic field in a quantum field theory. In keeping with the general feelings at that time, it seemed that the quantum field could not be used as a basic observable in the theory. What people were measuring were cross sections of particles and not fields. And so, actually Heisenberg already 10 years earlier had tried to eliminate the field altogether on his search for true observables and developed his concept of an S-matrix. Meanwhile, Heisenberg had given up that line. In fact, I remember a few years later, when I was in Göttingen, he used to say, "The S-matrix is the roof of the theory, not its foundation," which was very good at the time because there was a development by Chu, who had taken up Heisenberg's S-matrix element theory again. Well, anyway, so in 1953, I did not want to throw out the field altogether, but since the whole development was, of course, if you look at textbooks in quantum field theory, you start with a free field and you get the equivalence of the fields with creation operators for particles. So the synonymous feeling of fields equal with particles, this duality was, so to say, taken over in interacting quantum field theory, but with no real interpretation of the basic field itself. So I did not want to throw out the field altogether, but I thought that it should be just used as an interpolation between an incoming field, which is a free field, and an outgoing field, which is also a free field, which are the creation operators of incoming and outgoing particles. And this interpolation was fixed by some asymptotic condition of convergence of the fields towards the incoming or outgoing fields at plus or minus infinity in time. And since I knew about strong and weak conversions at that time, and I knew also that in collision theory of quantum mechanics, the conversions of the e to iht to e to the minus ih0t to the Möller operator, there was strong convergence. So I just postulated that the field should converge strongly to the asymptotic fields at plus minus infinity. Now that was unfortunately wrong. And I should have known that if I had been more careful, but actually I was not careful. Now at the same time, about in Göttingen, Lehmann, Szymanczyk and Zimmermann worked on their paper with practically the same attitude, also reducing the field to its role of interpolation between minus infinity and plus infinity, and they got the correct form of the asymptotic condition in their famous paper zur Formulierung quantisierter Feldtheorien, which also gave a beautiful algorithm for computing S-matrix elements. So that was the situation then in 54, I would say. Now, soon, however, I began to become very doubtful of this whole scheme for various reasons. I mean, first of all, if the field was only used as an interpolation between incoming and outgoing fields, there was no particular reason why it should be strictly local. I mean, there were non-local theories like Müller-Christensen, could be just as well. That was one reason. The other reason was that, after all, it was very unnatural that a field, it needed, so that it cemented the correspondence between fields and particles. And that was very unnatural. If you think that there are composite particles like atoms or nuclei or whatever, then certainly you don't want to introduce an independent field for each of them. So this whole scheme of interpolating fields was just, so to say, a situation good for simple situations, but it was not really fundamental. So worrying about that, I arrived at the idea which we are supposed to celebrate today. Namely, I recognized that the true observables, or the basic observables, are neither the fields, nor the S-matrix elements, nor even cross-sections. All these are already derived concepts which need a little bit of theory. The basic observations are just detector signals. And a detector sits somewhere, it occupies some region in space, and it gives a signal in a specific time interval. So what the information is that some event happened in a particular space-time region, period. Now, we don't know what classification of events, we don't know, so to say, various types of detectors. The development of higher sensitivity and higher selectivity and the distinction between different types of events, all that is a long process involving experimentally trial and error, and the many placements of different sources, different geometries of detector arrangements to, so to say, develop the theory and to develop, so to say, the instruments which are suitable. But the basic thing is that we need for each space-time region the set of all... Was ist passiert?
Das Mikrofon funktioniert nicht richtig. Wir müssen leider dann nochmal ran.
Welches?
An dem rechten. An
das
dem
ist rechten. Das für den...
für die Aufnahme.
Für die Aufnahme, ja.
Sie wissen, wo man da was regeln kann? Entschuldigung.
Nee, das ist eigentlich okay.
Entschuldigung, so.
Gut, ja. Okay, danke schön. So, what was I saying? Yeah, maybe this works here. So with some idealization, it would be important to that since we do not know individually which element on the mathematical side corresponds to which piece of hardware, and we don't have to know that a priori at all, it is important to gather the collection of all possible events which can happen in a particular space-time region. And with some idealization, that could be represented by some algebra associated to that region. And I think I have here, hopefully, let's see. Yeah, indeed. So that led to the idea that to every space-time region O, there should be a corresponding algebra of operators in Hilbert space, for instance, called I of O. Yeah, that's all there is in this picture here. And the, how to say, the immediate benefit of this point of view was for collision theory. It was now clear that you could, of course, from this I of O, you just need to take some operator which connects the vacuum with a particular particle state. And if it just creates a particle and nothing else, then it converges strongly. And if it creates something else in addition to that particle, then it converges weakly. And so you get a generalization of LSE to all possible particle types. And that led to the development of collision theory, which Henning Riehrn already mentioned. Now, let's see, this is probably all over. Excuse me, it's a little bit painful because I can't, even with a lens, I can't see well. I'm sorry, just take a little time. I can see. Okay, thank you very much. Yeah, the role of quantum fields could be then just that it establishes the correspondence between the mathematical objects and namely the fields and the space-time. These algebras could be, in a simple quantum field theory, could be just constructed by taking polynomial algebras of these fields smeared out over the regions with some test functions. And that is indeed what I proposed at the Lille conference. But, of course, other specifications of these algebras were also possible. Now, coming to the Lille conference itself, it took place not in 59, but in 57, spring 57. And so it is actually 52 years since that conference. But luckily, there was two years delay in publication, which was due to a language problem. See, this was a conference which was sponsored by the French government financially, and they, of course, wanted justly that the French language be honored. So everything should be presented in French, but nobody could speak French. So all the lectures were in English, and then they had to be translated into French by mainly Louis Michel, and that took 2 years. So it was actually a very selfless effort of Louis Michel to organize all this material in French language. And the advantage of this is that nobody today can read it anymore. not everybody, I mean, there are people who know French, but it is not the most language. Yeah. Well, the conference actually was a milestone in some sense. It was perhaps the first conference in which mathematical physics, in the sense we know it now, was happening, because there were participants from pure mathematics, Laurent Schwartz, in particular from Paris, and Madame Choquet-Briard. And another mathematician was Caio Friedrichs from New York, who had written a book on quantum mathematical aspects of quantum field theory, Irving Siegel from Chicago, who always liked to make physical theories also. He was a mathematician. And on the physics side, there was, well, let me try to remember, Weidmann, there was Chelene, there was Daniel Kastler, there was Louis Michel, there was Joost and Lehmann and Van Hove, yes, thank you. Yeah, that's me myself. That's about what I remember. And now at this conference, the Weidmann talked about his vision of axiomatic quantum field theory. Joost and Lehmann were concerned with dispersion relations and analytic properties of retarded functions. Who else was? Chelene. He said that he disliked the philosophy of Weidmann completely, but nevertheless they worked well together in trying to get the most general form of the three-point function. I don't know. Yes, of course, and Irving Siegel, he earned the scorn of all the physicists there by suggesting that one should not talk about Hilbert space operators, but take abstract C-star algebras. Now, our scorn was in parts justified, because he had not given any reason for that, and because he did not offer a physical interpretation which was reasonable. On the other hand, looking back at this now, I would think that if we had a little bit less arrogant and thought about it, we could have been helpful at that time, because I could have supplied him most of the interpretation, namely by applying the C-star idea not to the whole algebra, but to the local algebras and the states. Now, that is what, in fact, Daniel Kastler and I did 7 years later. So, it's one of these cases where, so to say, you just don't think sufficiently about something and pass. It's opportunity lost, or at least later recognized. Yeah. Now, in my talk, in which I presented this idea with the local algebras and its application to collision theory, I could not resist the temptation to say at the end that it was absolutely a shame that nobody before had ever thought about a proper collision theory for many channel processes. And then somebody in the audience said, but there is a paper by a person called Eckstein on this subject in a recent issue of Physical Review. And so when I went home to Göttingen at the time, I looked up at Eckstein's paper and I saw that it was largely the same idea. And so I just added an apologetic footnote to my contribution. And some year later, when Eckstein met me in Princeton, that was, he said, if I had not written that footnote, he would have classified me as a crook. But with this footnote, it was the beginning of a lifelong friendship. So you see that things are very... Yeah, okay. Now going for a few years back, I just want to say that in fall 55, when I was in Munich, my chief professor Fritz Popp and his colleague in the mathematics department, Wilhelm Hack, Mark, they thought again that it would be good to renew the direct contact between mathematics and physics, and they organized a seminar for that purpose. Now that seminar did not have many participants. In fact, it was just Mark and his two assistants, and it was Bob and myself who were part in the seminar. But for me, it was of paramount importance. It was there that I was made acquainted with the work of von Neumann on operator algebras, and also with the work of Gelfand and Neimark on involutive algebras. And 3 years later, when I was thinking about, so to say, making the mathematical side of this correspondence between fields and between algebras and regions more precise and also independent of the quantum field theoretical background, I came back to these von Neumann algebras, and that is probably what I should take my next slide here. Now if I can read that, I use the symbol R for a von Neumann algebra, just to distinguish it from A, also because von Neumann called it for some reason which I don't know, rings instead of algebras. Do you know, Masamichi, why he called it rings? Pardon me?
It was fixed measure name von Neumann.
Rings of operators, or not algebras. But okay. Anyway, so I call it R. Anyway, they are algebras. Now, the thing which fascinated me was the correspondence between this theory von Neumann and the causality in space-time. If we have a region O, there is a causal complement, the set of all points which are space-like to O, and on the, let us see, did I always, let me try to see, as a, yeah, now that we had already, yeah, now the Einstein causality is, yeah, for some reason I haven't written it, where is the commutant of, oh, the commutant of a ring R at the top, yeah? You have an algebra R and you have its commutant called R prime, and you have O and O prime, and there is this thing that the causality condition is just that the algebra of the space-like complement is contained in the commutant of the other algebra, that is this condition here. And now if you are a little bit ambitious, it is tempting to strengthen that to the second line, to the last line here, that actually they are equal. This, that it's a maximality condition, that all the elements which commute with a particle wind, they are the algebra of the causal complement. Now this I found very tempting, and in particular it has a strange consequence, namely that in this picture you see the shaded region is some region O, and the double cone, the diamond here, is the causal completion, every points which are causally connected to the elements in O, and the duality condition says that these two are equal. In other words, all the elements in the algebra of this diamond here can be computed from the ones in the space line, which means there should be an equation of motion of hyperbolic type, as we, or something like that. I mean, that is one consequence of this dualistic condition. Of course, if John is here, I should make one piece of warning. This duality condition was used later in this approach of analyzing the superselection sectors, but there it was used only for double cones, or for these diamonds, not implying this, what I just said, which is under the equation of motion. Anyway, so that was one reason why I thought that the Fondamine algebras were particularly useful for this thing and fitted to the space-time causal structure. All this has been organized. Now, what is the time now? What the past?
Half an hour.
It was half an hour, so we're going slow, yeah? Yeah. Well, yeah, well, what I have here is that in the years around 1960s there was little interest in algebraic field theory, but people were patient and friendly. In particular in Princeton, I had the patient ear of Walya Barkman, who gave me many good advices, in particular also the one that I shouldn't focus on observables only. There were many mathematical theorists which lived on the use of redundant quantities. And in fact, we should perhaps come back to that. In Urbana then, I had the help of two excellent collaborators who sit here. That is Bert Schroer and Hosiro Araki. And together we developed this scheme of von Neumann algebras, of these nets of von Neumann algebras, in a way that all the, so far, the postulates in one field theory were formulated in this way. And Hosihiro checked that in the case of free fields, and he found one interesting thing in addition, namely that the type, so-called type, of these von Neumann algebras could not all be of type 1. And the type 1 is the type of von Neumann algebras which with physicists were familiar so far, and nothing else they ever had met. And also the mathematicians had not many examples of algebras not of type 1. So this was immediately a great interest in the mathematical areas. Now, yeah. Now there was the next development was that came from the gauge theories, global gauge theories. The existence of charge implied that in the sense of Wigner there were superselection rules between states of different charge. There could be no interference between them. So the Hilbert space decomposed into a sum, direct sum of sectors, incoherent sectors, in each of which there was a representation of the observable algebra. So I found this somewhat unnatural, this, and I thought that maybe we should say that all these are inequivalent representations of one and the same abstract algebra in the sense which Siegel had presented much earlier. Now when Daniel Kastler came to Urbana for a year, we worked out this, and with his mathematical knowledge, and that was the beginning of this other next step in this development, where we had a net of C-star algebras and considered different inequivalent representations of that. Now I want to end, so to say, my reminiscences at this time and talk now a little bit about achievements. I have already spent maybe too much time on the things, so I will keep the achievements somewhat short, because anyway, you, most of you know them anyway, and I just mentioned, so to say, some headlines. Don't discuss them in detail. So one thing was just following from Araki's discovery of the strange types in these examples, that there was a long, very fruitful, close interaction between mathematicians and physicists, which after, let's see, how many years, 10 years, 15 years, led to ultimately to a complete classification of all von Neumann algebras, vectors, by the work of quite a number of people. Most eminently was, of course, Tomita and Takasaki, who is sitting here. And then Araki and Woods. I don't know, is Woods here? No. And then ultimately Alain Conn and Hagerup also to some extent. So there were lots of people also whom I did not mention, but these were the main contributors who ultimately achieved this complete classification. For physics, I think now one of the lasting contributions or achievements was the application to statistical mechanics in the infinitely extended media, that is directly in the thermodynamic limit, which was easily possible in this algebraic setting because we have these local algebras, and if we have a state, it gives an expectation value on each of these local algebras, so it doesn't matter whether we have them up to infinity or whether they have a wall somewhere. So that was then actually also when Nico Hugenholz visited us in end of 65, then we worked that out. This was so to say, the algebraic form, the representation of the algebras, which is resulting from an equilibrium state and its things which are generated by it, rather than from the vacuum. I mean, the usual things was before we had considered the vacuum representations, now we consider the representations in based on equilibrium state, and this KMS condition for Kubo, Martin Schwinger, who had given that relation before, they were really starting point for very many applications in calculations, statistical mechanics, as for instance written in the books by Bratelli and Robinson and described there. So this, I think, was an important application. What else do we have? Yeah, of course, here. The analysis here of also people who are here, namely Doblicher and Roberts, of the super selection sectors, global gauge groups, charge structure, and its connection with the permutation symmetry of identical particles. Bose Fermi statistics, Parabose, Parafermi statistics. This was a wonderful scheme. And it had, yeah, there was an extension of that later by Buchholz and Friedenhagen, which is very important. Namely, in our first approach, we started from, we had a selection criterium for the states of interest, namely only those which look like the vacuum far away. And look like the vacuum far away, we somewhat overemphasized that. and that led to the notion of charges. We are strictly localizable in some finite region. Now, Borges had another criterion of selection of states which was weaker and was probably more reasonable, namely positive energy states. And Buchholz and Friedenhagen worked out from this Borges criterion, and they found, let us see, that there is possibility of having charges which are extended in a space-like cone up to infinity. And these type of charges, of course, are very, will meet very importantly in the local gauge theories. That was one development. The other one was by Friedenhagen, Schroer, and Rieren and Schroer, yeah? Namely the application to lower dimensional cases in which completely new phenomena came about. Namely, instead of the permutation statistics, permutation group, you had the Barrett group, and with a much more complicated situation, with many other fall-offs into mathematics, with contact with Warren Jones, towers of inclusions, etc. And I think Longo, is Longo here? Hmm? Here? Ah, yeah, good. So Rieren and Longo, they worked on this very much. So this was a whole other area of things. Now, what else do we have? Yeah, I wanted to mention one other area which application of this was important. That was the quantum field theory in curved space-time. We will probably hear many talks about that here. And for that purpose, also the idea of local algebras was very helpful, because it made clear what the problem was. You could take over the idea of local algebras just as you had it before, because in an external field, the gravitational field, the causal structure is given, so you know what should commute. So this is unchanged. The only thing that you need is what you don't have in the curved spacetime is the vacuum and the positive energy condition, because there is no global energy definable in general. So this has to be replaced, and that replacement in the small, either by, so to say, a scaling limit and going over to tangent space, where you could define, so to say, the Minkowski situation again and get the positive energy condition, or let's see, what you call this, the micro-local, micro-local condition. Also, this replaces the positive energy requirement, and that gives you immediately also, so to say, a approach to the phenomenon of Hawking radiation. The condition of this positive energy restricted to the infinitesimal region, that is the condition why in a black hole you get the Hawking temperature. Now, what else do we have? I should mention, of course, also the infrared problems, for which the classical paper by Detlef Buchholz is very important, also contribution by Bert Schroer. Your contribution was not based on algebraic field theory, but Bert had the infrared particles, the effect that a particle in the quantum electrodynamics has no sharp mass, and so we call this infraparticles. But related to that is, of course, the infrared clouds associated with collision processes, and that was studied by Detlef Buchholz in his paper on the stage space of quantum electrodynamics. Now, what else do I have? Yeah. Well, There are of course many other applications or achievements which are however more of an internal form, that they give us information about the nature of these algebras in one way or another, the nuclearity conditions. The most famous one is the Bisignano-Wittmann thing, that the modular automorphisms in a wedge is known, Lorentz transformations, etc. So there are many of these things, although the type of the Feynman algebras as type 3.1 is universally known. So there are such things which I don't really go into. Now one may regret somewhat that the algebraic approach has somewhat remained on the fringes of the interest of the scientific community, and that has several reasons. One reason, of course, is that we cannot compete with the fascination of the phantom of string theory. So that's sure we'll have some opinions on that. we should not attempt. But also there may be some criticism, which brings me to my last point, and probably that is a point, missed opportunities, which unfortunately Detlef does not like very much. we have just different opinions. Now, I think that one reproach one can make to the algebraic is that there has been a little bit of a sectarian spirit of isolation from other branches of development. And in particular, to illustrate this, in my opinion, I don't know, that is my different opinion, that the understanding of local gauge theories, which after all was one of the chief progress between end of 60s and 70s, the development of electroweak interaction as a local gauge theory, and of chromodynamics, which was, so to say, the best existing approach to we have in elementary particle physics. that was more or less not accompanied by an effort on our side. And I remember, for instance, Harry Lehmann, in one of his rare moments of self-criticism, he said, well, we have been very foolish. For 20 years we have taken as a prototype of the theory this scalar meson field self-interacting, instead of thinking of what the simplest generalization of quantum electrodynamics is. And indeed, this local gauge theories are very natural in the classical sense, and Yang-Mills theories, with we understand them on the classical level very well. They are with fiber bundles, with sections and connections, and it's very natural because the fiber bundle just means that it is not possible to have a coordinatization which is naturally preserved, but you have many possibilities of assigning coordinates which are all equivalent, and moreover it is not so that you can fix this by choosing a single origin, but it depends how you go from one place to another to identify, so to say, equal situations. So this is a very natural idea which has been also around for a long time, and it proved its worth in the development of these theories later. Now, in 1974 there was the paper by Becky Ruiz-Dora, which is, so to say, the accepted version in quantum field theory, how to treat these things. In end of the 70s, you finished your analysis of the global theories, and in 82, Detlef and Klaus Friedenhagen published their extension with this localization in cones. And since that time, 82 to 2009, that's 20 years or whatever. So we did not really address this problem of getting the bridge between Becquerel-Soa and our knowledge here. Now, okay, if I say that's a missed opportunity, then of course that is, one may doubt that because it's just a very tough question and maybe it's not our meat to do that. And thinking about this again, I had hoped that I could outline, so to say, a little bit of an approach to that, but unfortunately I can do a little bit, but not much. It is a tough problem, and actually we could say that if we just take from the classical analogy the situation that we need as a charge creation automorphisms, extended things which extend to from a point to infinity, so this kind of H strings here. There is, so to say, a charge creation point plus here maybe going over with a gauge bridge to the other end where we have the opposite charge, and if you think that opposite charge moves to infinity and where you can, so to say, orbit it, you have, so to say, the prototype of how a charge creation operator should look in this case. And that fits perfectly well with the Buchholz-Friedenhagen analysis. Now, with this analysis, you could, of course, do all the, has been done, all the things which you have done before in the localized charge case. You can take the many particle states, you can take the statistics, all this can be done, has been done. But what is lacking is, so to say, the transition to the, so to say, to the infinitesimal ones, to a field theory. And the question of what kind of additional non-observable quantities do we need in addition to these. Now you see, of course, one thing you see immediately, if you want additivity, that is to say that, which is a typical case of field theory, that the algebra of a larger region can be obtained by taking a covering and taking the algebras of the smaller regions together, then you have to chop away these large lines here going to infinity into pieces. That is one thing, and if you think of shrinking that more and more, the separation from this point to the line is also an open question what that means. It's a discussion of the singularity type of these line-like and surface-like, point-like objects, which reminds me of what you did in the case of the point-like fields, Friedenhagen and Hertel some time ago. But here, the same for other geometric things which are not points but lines and so on. So I think that is what is missing. And of course also the question is then where do these indefinite metric come in? That is probably, okay, we know that to some extent, but still I think it would be worthwhile to really try to do that, and it's very tough to do it, but you see, if you have a tough problem, it's like a dog who has a bone which is too large, so he turns it around one way and another way, and so on. One single person probably cannot do it. One has to have really a concerted effort of several people and really attack the problem from all the sides. I'm thinking now, for instance, of the wonderful time we had in Urbana, in which we met every afternoon for a few hours, three or four people, and we discussed the problem and went home, thought about it, and came back next day again, discussed again. If one applies such a situation, which unfortunately is not easily done nowadays, but okay, then I think one should make some headway. So this is one problem, and in fact it reminds me also of another one which I thought was important, namely to find a way which to characterize a specific theory within this general frame. And some years ago I tried to do that with Ojima by thinking that this specification must be done in the small, because it is typically done by giving a Lagrangian density. So we tried to work out something like a germ of the theory, and of course that has been continued. I don't know precisely to what extent now, but Postelmann has worked on this very hard, Detlef also. So but this is also something which comes in here, because the field equations, for instance, question also why Fermi fields, all these things we should try to understand to make the connection with what people usually do in high energy elementary particle physics. Now, of course, just this morning I had a discussion with Detlef, and he thinks that there are other approaches, and that's fine, but I still think that it would be good to close such bridges just also for sociological purposes, that one has joint meetings with other workers who speak a different language. So I think I have to, what is the time? I probably run over time already. Pardon me?
Quarter to 11.
So,
yes, I
have run over the time already.
No.
No? Okay. So anyway, let me close now and say that we will see in the next days how many other ideas have been developed, and if I have, so to say, do not take my missed opportunities as a reproach, but just as a suggestion. So thank you very much.
Revealing talk, it was even revealing to me. I mean, the very early history of the talk. Are there any questions on the historical part?
Please. Yeah, I have just a comment on this French government directive that you spoke about.
Yeah.
I think that the French physicists, including Michel, were more kindly disposed to this directive. And my teacher, John Dulune, one of the founders of the Bourbaki group, told me that they were already writing their books in French.
Yes.
But they did not want to be told by the government what to do. As a result of this, his address at the International Congress of Mathematicians in Moscow, he and the other Bourbaki members had prepared their speeches in French, but they threw them and spoke in English. And Rothenlieg, who was awarded the Fields Medal at that meeting, also did the same. And apparently, after they got back, there was the question of the funding, but then the government issued a note saying that it was just a strong suggestion and the funding would not be effective.
Yes, it's okay. Thank you.
Could I ask you about your opinion of the theory of Fritz Koester and co-workers, who claim to have a relativistic theory which fulfills everything which you can formulate in terms of particles? And he also told me that that Stückelenberg severely criticized Heisenberg with his S-matrix theory on the point of lack of macro-causality, which you can formulate in terms of particles. Mm-hmm. So Stückelenberg extracted from this a Feynman propagator for very large distances only, and he
he extrapolated it to the point and had the fine one rules without having operators.
Mm-hmm.
Have you noticed this?
Well, I know the work of Fritz Koester. In fact, I was involved in this in the beginning somewhat. But, well, I think phenomenologically it is possible if you just, but the idea was to follow, let's say, point mechanics, that you you describe the situation of several particles by giving position and momentum variables, and then the question of the interaction formulated in such a way is very difficult to achieve that you that you have the right cluster property afterwards. And Fritz Koester, together with, I forget the name,
Polizou,
they gave such a scheme how that can be done. Now, that's, I think, very useful also for phenomenological analysis in nuclear physics, but I don't think it's a fundamentally good theory because, well, I mean, it lacks the field concept, it lacks, so to say, the, what we know, that in electrodynamics, for instance, you have also photons and not only hard particles. So I think it's as a theory itself, it's okay, but I don't think it has a great scope.
But it disproves the conjecture of Weinberg, who claimed that knowing a relativistic S-matrix with these properties of factorization, there's always a local quantum field theory behind it.
Probably, yes.
Shows that this cannot
be. Probably so, yes. So,
if there are no more comments or questions, we have a break now. Thank you again.